These now come from quantum mechanics. And there are two types. First, quantum analog of the magnetic monopoles, now called spinels. And also, we can think about the same sort of objects. This is a source of electric flux I described before. And therefore, we have electric monopoles. And these appear on different energy scales. So now I focus on the non-primers, hyperons, and say a few words about what are the sources of these strong burst fluctuations that are needed to stabilize the quantum surprise. So first, has been introduced in this paper by Yoda in 2010, that actually protoballs can play a role. I want to illustrate this simply. I can find a version of what we have done in plasma contains in the head of the crystal field. From this, you can get the ground state wave function for plasma super state. And from this, you can draw actually the in red here is the dipole drive function density in green here, some parabola electron density. That's what you need to use to produce the strong burst fluctuations. Still in non-primer systems, there is another ingredient that is very important, which is dissolved. And it has been introduced actually last year by Silzari and Yonvalens, that dissolver can induce quantum spin in non-primer spinized systems. And that's what happens in. And if you do a little bit of dissolver, it produces strong burst fields that act as a source of strong burst fluctuations. But if you go to a stronger dissolver, and actually the dipole moments are in the strong burst direction, and you suppress them, and you get essentially quadrupole degrees of freedom, and therefore you don't expect an elastic This has been discussed as well in the talk by Owen Benton at the beginning of the week. So the big disorder region is here and stabilizes the quantum spin heights. And this is the parameter with actually quadrupole conditions. So as long as I'm dealing with disorder, just to remind you what are the types of effects that we can find in power problems. So you know that there is a stability field that can be more destroying. So as a function of the radius of the two-type ions, okay, you can do a certain case. And also as a function of chemical bounding, you will stabilize or not the power of phase. And if you go outside of this region of stable power of phase, then you will form a defective fluoride. Therefore, maybe the type of lowest energy structural defects that you expect in the pyrochore phase, if the pyrochore is not perfect, are the defects to go from this pyrochore to the defective fluoride. And especially anti-titanium defects, which reverse the position of the anions, the AAB sites, or some sort of anion disorder. You can also, of course, imagine that the sonar is not stoichiometric, either in terms of oxygen or in terms of cations. And this has to do with respectively thermal treatment or salty mixture or evaporation of the elements. So all this can be diagnosed quite finely up to a certain level of accuracy using the diffraction theory. And I go back to prosodium germinate, for example, since there are more possible to speak of prosodium spin activities. It was shown in this nice paper of last year that prosodium germinate, some sample's purely show drive peaks, which are not allowed in the private structure. So maybe there are two zeros of these. This is really talking about that there is a disorder in this house, at least in some of these numbers. And also other very nice work from last year, the group of CMT, shown that actually we had also very other signatures of the presence of disorder in the which is the fact that the defects that seem to exist they lead to a micro strain, which is something normal, and this can be actually measured as diffuse scattering. It is the and so if I want to compare the situation in terms of defects and disorder in Brazilian athlete compared to this, I can tell you, I can show you such data, I can only tell you that we are looking for these things and that they are not present. We look quite hard, these are the similar maps to this. The graphics are very sharp, there is no diffuse scattering, but its crystals are very nice. It doesn't mean that there is absolutely no disorder. It means, for sure, that if there is disorder, then it's much bigger than the Brazilian geogranite. It also doesn't mean that it's not possible to get Brazilian geogranite without disorder. So now I'm going to start to show you some data about Brazilian athletes. And we start with macroscopic measurements. So first, these are bulk susceptibility measurements and micro-variation. So if you go low enough in temperature, you reach a regime where you can measure a nice, very nice regime here down to about 5 Kelvin, where there is something happening, and where the susceptibility increases faster than the device behavior, which indicates some ferromagnetic correlations, which is what you hope for if you think your sample is going to enter spin isolated correlation. Second sort of thing that we get some synchronized physics going on is to measure magnetization versus speed below this alpha k temperature and to look at the 111 magnetization of the 111 direction. We observe this kink here, which was not observed in transmutate, and correspond to beta magnetic process between 2 in 2 out and 3 in 1 out. So now I come to neutral scattering and we look at the temperature dependence on power system. It's a very good resolution, the elastic line of this resolution here, about 50 microEV. And what you see is that below this same temperature of time to Kelvin, there is a change of frame, exactly as in the single crystals mentioned before. And this change of regime is basically showing two things. So first, here, you see it also here, when you compare half of Kelvin and 15 Kelvin, you get first elastic scattering within this resolution. That grows below this temperature here. And there are also changes at the same time in the inelastic scattering. So you sort of open it up here, get some spectral waves, which is here. So there are two contributions below this temperature of Kelvin, where we think quantum spinized physics happens. So now I turn to the single crystal results of neutron scattering, and I show you in the next slide, that these two contributions also exist in the single crystal data. This is the gaussiastic contribution, and this is the inelastic contribution. So, measure of that elastic time is a very good resolution of, again, 15 micrometers. And this is about 0.2 MeV, where the intensity of the inelastic scattering moves. So there are different Q-level intensity signals, and especially this one has a clearly a synchronized like structure with pinch points, which given the size of the magnetic moment indicates at least an exchange driven synchronized system. I would like to stress here some differences with Sparsity and Zimmerlin. There are very nice work here over the last couple of years. I think these two balances are very famous, and they are from this paper by Kimura. There are really nice data, they inspired us. I would just like to note so two things. In Brazil, there is an essential difference with Brazilian athletes, which is that there is essentially no elastic gaussiastic contribution. The spectral weight is essentially inelastic. And to understand this statement, when you look at these panels, you need also to look at the resolutions with which they were measured. So here, it is integrated around 0.4 volts, but it's interacted with this resolution. Therefore, it includes this. So I'm just saying here that we cannot compare this panel with this one in terms of resolution. And so the response of positive is essentially here. So to go further, we then try to compare our gaussiastic structure factor with different models. So a classical spinized model, so your stable classical spinized, and a complex spinized model that includes photon excitations. And we did the fit discussion around the pinch points here with our data and the two models. And from this fit, so first, if you believe that the QSI model is fits better on data, and you can get an estimate of the speed of light. And this corresponds to a bandwidth from the photon excitation of about 10 micro-eV. This 10 micro-eV is contained within the integration range of this panel. So it justifies our approach. And second, so this analysis is it's not entirely discriminating, and therefore it's very useful to look at other aspects of the physics, and in particular in the inelastic transfer. This pattern I showed before, this Darfish pattern, is actually imprinted on the top of the continuum that we have measured with those polarized and non-polarized measurements. And so we believe that this continuum of spin excitations reflects the propagating polarities which are expected from the electromagnetic monopoles of quantum spinals. There are theoretical laws that predict that the bandwidth of these spindles or monopoles should be about 10 times the exchange, which seems to be the case. And also, we can compare the Starfish pattern with the results of quantum mechanical calculations, including the spindles here in this paper. And the last thing I would like to note is. In non-parameter systems, the transverse component of the spin is in fact affecting the rhythm of the emotional session. Magnetic monopoles and the spinels are not expected to be visible, except if there is a very big disorder that misses the diagram of the components. And last, the two monopoles continuum related to electric monopole have been recently related to the unitary in the investigation in this paper by the original so with this, I think I'm done. And I leave you with these conclusions, and I'm happy to answer your questions.
So thank you very much, Roman, for a very nice presentation. Do we have the questions?
So your evidence for the photons from the Q dependence of the intensity, so that is it correct that the dip in intensity at I guess gamma point is due to the odd intensity dependence where the intensity goes to zero at that point? Is that right? There is no photon intensity at zone center.
But this blue line here that is the data includes the photons.
And what is CSR?
It's a neural spin ball spin axis without the contouring factor exchange. And it's sort of, and if you look at the spectral of the distribution here, there is a region where it peaks, and so I follow what you say, maybe the region where it peaks, maybe the detection of holes, and here what is very more used to be.
Can you just, irrespective of the theory, can you say, irrespective of the theory, can you say how much weight is in that continuum?
I can compare it to the previous.
This question in the back.
Very nice and interesting talk. I'm interested in whether it is really maybe you want to check out the statement in the experiments and the formal monolithic. And the reason is that the large monolithic matter of the carbon flux state, if you observe, if you can identify the carbon flux, then you will see another phase in between the covalent state and also state, and that has intermediated by us, Fred Wood and myself, the non-possible solid. And in that case, you can see a phase transition, the function of temperature. This would mean that if you cool down the system, and then you will see a phase transition. So that would be easily checked by a specific measure.
Do you have any comment or is there any experiment on that? We're going to do additional experiments around this. There are a few of them, but yes, I want to try to make the phase I run with the best measurements.
Okay, so I think if you have time, we should move on to the next speaker. So let's thank Roman Sidil again. Now we move on to Sylvain.